for me, what it taught me is that there is a very can-do attitude in Kenya, and you all worked to deliver it. It might have been inconvenient. I don't know whether you made money or you did not, but you send a signal of hope to the country that we can rise up to the challenge. And that was actually one of the things we saw in the Kenyan business community last year. The things we had never done, like, you know, transport cargo in passenger seats, we did it, and we did it with a lot of pride. Things we had never done, like produce PPEs, we did it. And now you see them getting hawked in the streets. We even improved, we ensure that they are sealed. So, we've had quite a bit of improvement in that very, very short period. And that, I think, is something we need to celebrate. And for those of you in the business community, in the room and elsewhere, that's a spirit that we celebrate, that determination to make the best of a bad situation and to create solutions and to be very, very dexterous about it. I don't think we wrote long proposals. I doubt if we wrote many letters. I'm sure the meetings were, like you call each other, we are coming, and by the end of the day. So I certainly hope enough, because we are public institutions, you've kept the paper trail or corrected it much later to ensure that when the auditors come, it's like they can at least track how we did things. But even as we were solving these problems, you did it very, very quickly. We rely on yourselves, we rely on your partnership to be able to deliver the promise of new markets. The government has been negotiating for new markets all over. We're certainly engaged in negotiations with the United States, as you're aware, with the free trade agreement. We've done two rounds of it. We expect to get into more rounds as the new administration settles. But the commitment and the motivation of government in getting into these new agreements is to create space for our investors, to create space, both our local investors and those who are outside our country, to come and invest, because there's a promise of a secure market. We concluded the agreement with the United Kingdom in December last year, is when we signed on the December the 8th, and we're going through the process of our ratification. But the signal of that agreement is that your market in the United Kingdom is secure. We have the we have our market in the EU, which we have under the EPA. But it was important that as the UK exits the Europe, that those of us who sell, and a lot of you sell into the United Kingdom, the number of panicky calls I used to get from your customers, Alan and Dick, is we have contracts, we have this fresh produce, can we sell on the same terms? And it was our responsibility as government to provide the assurance that you could. But it's also a signal to others that once this market remains secure, you can now also invest and expand your production. And we have seen a lot of Kenyans go into agro production because of the assurance of this market. And that, it's something that we must continue to work on. So you can fly to the UK, you can be certain. Dick, I think as you do understand you're the finance man, as you do your projections, if these guys are selling to the UK, you can be certain it will be secure for the time as we have it. And now we will look into other markets. We've engaged with China as well to try and satisfy the SPS measures to require to be able to export fresh produce to those countries. And as you seek other markets, whether it is in Russia, whether it's in Japan, or it's in South Korea, whether it's in the Middle East, we sell a lot of meat, as you say, but not enough. They still buy meat from Australia. They still buy meat from Brazil. And you're trying to figure out, this meat from Brazil surely must pass Mombasa. And yet we have, we've got excellent beef herds and mutton and other things that we can sell. So I think the signal that government is sending with these trade agreements is that there is an opportunity for businesses to invest in Kenya because you have great assurance of market. All we can say is that we must ensure that all of us comply with the necessary standards. We've had some citations, we've had some, you know, interruptions of product and, you know, interceptions, as we call it, because sometimes we get so enthusiastic about this market and about these opportunities that we go and harvest avocado before it is quite ready. That we spray, you know, vegetables 3 or 4 days before you're shipping it out. Those things are going to lead to interceptions. And really it is important as leaders of the associations, we rely on self-implementation of the necessary regulations. It's not to say, like we sometimes, you know, when you're not wearing your seatbelt, it's like you only start to put it on when you see a cop. No, the seatbelt is for your safety. It's not for the cop's assurance. Therefore, standards and, you know, observance of good farming practices and standards is for the good of your business. You saw what happened with avocados this year, that we couldn't export because of a few naughty, you know, naughty people who are harvesting crop before it was ready. And that dents the reputation of the country. It loses you money today, but it dents the reputation of the country, and it takes so long to rebuild and get that reputation back. So if there is a message to your members, and it is a message that you must lead, I'm talking to now to the three musketeers, as you harass Dick at night, you must go back and harass your members and work with them and get into major voluntary compliance programs to ensure that we do not have any of these interceptions and we do not have any of these records of product, because it's going to affect. They will just say Kenyan products. They are not going to say Betty Miner's product. They're just going to say Kenyan products, and it affects everybody's reputation. So if there is anything that the industry must really invest in, it must invest in compliance and regulatory compliance and ensure that all the workers and all the farmers are well trained, both the small ones and the large organized ones. You know, Clement might say, my guys are organized, there are very few of them. So they look at you, Hosea, because you're the oldest and the widest in scope. But that also becomes a responsibility of the larger associations to work with FPIC and others to ensure that this, you know, there's widespread respect for regulations and widespread respect for compliance. So I thank you very much, and I wish you well in your partnership, and we see you leading in growth in our country as we take advantage of these markets and as we feed the world, as we humor the world with our flowers and bring in necessary, a necessary inspiration in these matters when we are so very depressed. At least we can lighten up and brighten up many lives with our lovely flowers, and we really work and expect that in a few years' time, when Kenya Airways posts its results, Dick, they should, you know, they should obviously work on your bonus as you build up, as you build up the cargo. He's also hoping you're listening. That really you can build up your cargo presence. I'm really glad to hear that news about the repurposing of a plane. I'm sure there are others that you can repurpose, but because if we can take advantage of this opportunity to re-engineer ourselves, we have the Africa Continental Free Trade Market, which we started trading at the beginning of January, and some of the things we intend to sell in Africa that are currently imported still includes processed vegetables and processed food, and that's going to be, and the role of Kenya Airways is going to be very critical in that regard. We promise you, and you're aware of government support in this regard, but it's not support that doesn't have accountabilities. It's not like we will always just say, it's a nice child, it's a nice child. You must also perform in order to earn that support. Asante sana, and good luck with the arrangements.